pull some stuff from this forum. You can switch to English right there. And go down to community. And you get to the forum. About to pull some stuff from here. Okay. The shock show and the that's gonna be a background of a lot of the words that we've been coming across in this series, the Canary Wars. So I'll throw this in that playlist and we will get a background of the author of the book that we're reading from. The fact also strange in the culture of the Gauchos and the religious practice of mummification. Shock show for the Gauchos. So that's what they call it. Shock show. Known in the island of Tenerife and Gran Canaria, although apparently, according to available archaeological evidence, not known in the rest of the island of the archipelago. It is strange because despite being a Gauchos of Amazigh origin, according to the available evidence, they did not know this practice among their mortuary rites in North Africa. If instead the Egyptians knew it, there is therefore no culture continuity between Egypt and the Canary Islands that passes through the continental Amazigh. In regards to this religious practice, to this religious practice also present in the high Andean cultures of the South American subcontinent. So it goes right into everything we've been saying. Chapter 47. chapter 47, 7 and 8. And the Canary Wars being over in South America, Peru, Colombia, Venezuela. Ghana Wars that deal with Brazil, Portuguese. So who could transmit through the Amazigh or Amazon of Tenerife and Gran Canaria the practice of mummifying the dead with methods very similar to what the Egyptians followed? it's possible that Yuba II had Egyptian delegates on both islands who went there, but the Amazigh group deported from North Africa. Yuba II was married to Cleopatra Selene II, 40 BC, 6 AD, the only child of Marco Antonio and Cleopatra. So, let's continue. It ain't gonna be too much time explaining because this ain't a translation from, this is a translation, but it's a modern day. It's just more basic stuff. Get into quick points. We are going to analyze what we have mentioned in small example of how much remains to be mentioned. So these people in this forum, wherever it belongs, got a few posts dealing with this book and dealing with the author, so you'll get into what they're talking about. We are going to analyze what we have mentioned, a small example of how much remains to be mentioned, of how much comes in the most relevant Arab books. For example, Abu al-Hasan al-Ibn al-Hasan al-Musiri say in the book titled Muri al-Dhab wa Madinu al-Yawa, the metals and gold and Jews metals. And written in 956, that an adventurer from Cordoba called the Yakhaj Ibn Sa'id Ibn al-Aswad crossed the Sea of Darkness, the Atlantic, with a group of friends until he reached the land behind the sea and returned in 1889. So, as the earliest time records started to be written on paper, we see references to travels to America. So what that tells us is that he already been travels, he just that. It's just hard pressed to find old records written on paper. Less people are translating papyruses, and even then we still gonna have to try to figure out what name was used for the Atlantic, the Americas, etc. at that time. So we still gonna be investigating. It's constant. It may be that whoever had read the story at that time had considered the author senile. But I have here a fragment of Musiri words that I will translate later. And I don't got that. You got to search the form. You might post it. He or she. This one, when returning from his trip, he confirmed to have found people who live in that land. And not only that, but also when he drew a map of the world, he placed behind the Sea of Darkness a land that I call the Unknown Land. With this, he made clear the existence of a land beyond, contrary to what was believed and as Europeans attended their maps and books. That is in the 9th century. Muslims already knew that there were land beyond the Sea of Darkness and that it did not refer to India, as confirmed by Christopher Columbus. And when they say Muslims, they're talking about themselves. After reading this book, they realized that they highly related to Moorish Americans. Based off those stories, and they're going off the religious aspect. So, you know, we know there are many tribes and stuff that have been like different worshippers and, you know, different gods. At the end of the day, all Islam, y'all sun and moon, and they all ancient. We call Islamism today, but another word for talismism. But anyway, this don't get too far. So, who traveled to that land and returned loved and loved? Bad translation. He died believing that it was India. So he lived and died believing it was India. It never crossed his mind that he discovered a new land. And we know that's a kind of contrived story. That's what has led Europeans to this day, and what all ignorance to America, West India. So, but we know now that West India and East India just been the name that Isabel decided to call her states. Her conquest, her conquered states. We find more examples in the language, because the Europeans drew origins. In 1564, a map of America in which Florida was, on which cited names of Andalusian and Moroccan cities, of course, for there to be Arab names there. And remember, Arab means noble. It's the ancient Canaanite word RB. It shouldn't take long. Wiktionary. If I'm gonna have to put, more stuff in there, they'll give me every damn bitch. Proto Canaanite. Semitic. Or Semitic. I think it's like this. Yeah. As you can see, it's RB. Where you get Lord, Order, and Chief. That's all. Take the fluff out of it. And you put, we make words like Arabia, which is the land, the chief land of the Lord. Land of the Lord is the land of the chief. The Arabic, I think, uses noble or one of them. That's why I tell them, boys, you got dictionarian coming in. You got professors, linguistics people, all kind of people. One dude I find, dude be killing with the ancient Greek. That's how I'm digging into them so we can see how the English, how we like even started to see words like Dr. D talking about catalog and we were talking about logos and licks, law, all those words, because coordinates. But we want specifically, oh yeah, apologize and catalog is synonymous. I mean, antonymous. Wana means a defender. He's an apologist. The L-E-G part in that shows that he's defender. He's a defender. And a cataloger. I'm gonna look that up in a second too. But yeah, that's R-B. Rabbi, I come from that Arab. That's what he said when he called one of the dudes Rabboni. Using that. So, you know, be sure that it don't matter which vowels, how you use your vowels, the R&B is the word in essence. So. We'll apologize. So when we read, we could be able to see that words ain't going to be fearful of. And I've been discussing this one before he even read this. Logos right there. From apology, speech, to render an account. You see, or defense. They say that's dated, but when you look at the word, it got logo in it, but you got different vowels, but the LG already stands. Can be L-E, that's what catalog and a bunch of words we've been just looking at, like, this shit is crazy. That's grand, figuring a speech made in defense of something. So that's a defender. So category, yeah, so he bet that. And I've been reading this off the, when you sign up as a Wiktionary, and you can be able to find different words and stuff, but the person who wrote this gotta ask a good shit like this. So let's see, category. So the accuser, so the person who was the prosecutor, so categorizer and apologizer, defender and prosecutor. So just know every word got origins. We don't need to worry about what nobody in these times with us, who living today with us, gotta tell us, cause we can go find everything for ourselves. In these times especially. But I had a Wiktionary account since about 2005. I forget I had one that long ago. And I never did nothing with them until like later on, but I don't know, about 2012 or something like that. I had checked the account, do some kind of screen read, but it was getting like, so like I don't want to make first few videos. That's the oldest map of the place. Alright. This ain't even, but this one got some other money. Unless they take them off before they put on Wikipedia. These ones they be showing up. Put in one of those words. Let's put in Morocco. I think that's what it's been. At that time. About the site, that's a good site. Let's just zoom for real. Shit. Probably not on this map. Yeah, so why are you playing with this map? Hope you can see the rock right there. Read about this king and this one. You see the crowns by these kingdoms. And Saturnia. Got some stories. And you can read about the story of and then all these people. Been all these kings been known as Caquique in the Spanish records, which we know as Sharife, or Shagwe, a sheik, a sheriff, a chief, same shit. And yeah, Chikor, Kikor. And look at old Meek and this and shit. Already right there. But you can see the language though is a form of Latin. And they got friends were all French. Can't remember. suite of languages, the MR. Already let it look, you know what it is. And we find Pedica. On the same map. And that's a different version. That's what we're looking at. Talking about it in a G-Store. It's mostly only that, you know, once they get their hand on something, they gotta put their hand on everything. Yeah, Utina, that's another one, it's like Utica. That's a good book too. I think that's a book. Yeah, that's a real choice. Read about that. Mayakra, Kadika, with the C's, but the Arabic spelling with the K's, and the Punic Latin. So the American version is just a little mixed up, a bunch of different ones. It's like the Maltese. And similar morphology of the languages. So they talk about that. So fall down and stupid. Anyway. So based on the Duchess of Medina Sidonia, based on her documents. So we get into that book. We research. Wrote a book of great importance, which I encouraged her to do. Since through my studies on the Moors, I have discovered a strangely particular aspect. It is that I discovered that in 1644 there was an attempted plot in the old Al-Andalus with the objective of liberating it from Spain and recovering the sovereign Islamic state in which there were four parts. The King of Portugal, just after regaining his independence, lost in the Battle of the Three Kings, for which he annexed to Spain. A character from the city of Almeria called Taher Ahur. The document did not give their Christian name but intended. To be lost. out to the Beni Ammar and Ibn, the sons of Ammar. But the word Ammar, the age is unnecessary, and we get Amaricanos, which would also mean the same thing. The Canos being the suffix. And start in a revolt with a group of people. So a story. Third, the Moors of Ribahu and the Moroccan documents pretended to want to collaborate with the Christians. However, their true intentions were to free Andalus, as they planned to enter Guadalquivir with some boats and take Seville. Fourth, the Duke of Medina Sidonia, who ruled in our Andalus region, and thus the ancestor of the Duchess who ruled in the Al-Andalus region in the name of the King of Spain. So that's a big, huge achievement. How can it be that the Duke of Medina Sidonia, who represented the Christian authority of Al-Andalus, took part in a plot aiming at liberating Andalus? So he get on to talking about who can figure that out, but she ended up sharing like they've been practicing Islam behind the scenes. You can get into it. There is also a map of Ahmed al-Uthmani from 1559, which clearly demonstrates the great knowledge of the American continents by Muslims, which in any case exceed that of Europeans. Actually, Europeans were afraid of the Ottoman Empire occupying America, that they were thrown out of them. While in the 16th century, Muslims were still in Spain and the Moors suffered oppression and persecution. They continued to fight, and while Africans, as I mentioned earlier, through the story of Tor Happen, the leader in 1969, who demonstrated through the trip he made from Morocco from the Moroccan city of Asafi to the Caribbean, that perhaps the Egyptians had been there before. Why? Well, they noticed a great similarity between the Aztec and the Egyptian culture. In Peru, Brazil, and the south of the United States. We just finished looking at that map. Books were discovered that demonstrated the existence of Africans, quote unquote, since they contain writings of African characters exactly in the language of the Mandinkas. Because you got the same people on both sides. The historians and the scientists and everybody else got a million names, but we keep it simple. An entire Muslim town called Fulani, or with Arabic Kufi letters. Thus, the Mandinka language left its mark on the American peoples, but in reality, said time extended from the Caribbean to the north and south of the two Americas, meaning they ain't left no mark on the American people because they are the American people. So in reality, but you know, they will find all that language and still make it look like those some other people who come in heal when other people already been healed. Some shit that they can't prove, or they add to the story that the evidence don't suggest, or some shit. Because they always want to go around this. Everything got to be built around in their mind, subconscious. Is it possible that the Spaniards had a race? Is it possible that the Spaniards had a race that traces of all Islamic and Mandinka existence to they left absolutely nothing? That would be too much. Yep. And we went back to the books of the first European discoveries, including Christopher Columbus. Anybody get into the same thing that we doing? If you go back and read those differently, you start to see anomalies. And those ain't anomalies, those just something that we got defined differently today. That been defined like the back then, if that makes sense. Yann Coffin, a French writer, say in his book Less But Better Is the Americue, the Berbers of America. That one, see, that's another word. So we now got like six different words for this. You're just talking about ancient people who just go through time. But you got different people over time who just keep coming right in the story, their way. That on that continent lived a tribe called the Almami, a term known in West Africa whose meaning is the Imam. And that reference to Muslim leaders who were mostly in Honduras, Central America, of course, before Columbus. So yeah, many of these stories, you know, we can read the book, they came before Columbus and stuff like that. But you know, in our circle seven, everything that we talk about right now already in chapter 47, Africa, Berberia, Egypt, all those words that all these authors using. So he giving to you concise so he won't put you to sleep. You can focus on what you can do for your nation. Everybody need to be historians and shit. You can be a botanist, but you got your history, your family intact, your records. Solidarity. And everything fall in line. The truth ain't need all this, but ever since he make those claims, people were coming behind him saying the same thing. Decade after decade, if we go to Barry Hill, he used the terms Egyptian, Canaanites, same terms that he using, isn't he? And all Barry Hill do is American inscriptions and stuff like that, languages, ancient languages. And he about 50 years or 30 or 40 years after the circle sale. And then you got Isabel Alvarez. And then you got these historians. You got they came before Columbia, got all those same things, but I guess you could find all those words in that one fucking chapter. Stop playing. That's very even funny. He said an Iraqi friend offered me an Arab manuscript of 120 pages that he brought from a library in Germany. Since he knew my interest in Islam in America, with a very beautiful Eastern Arabic letter written by a man called Fulanito al-Baghdadi, originally from Baghdadi, all right, by who loved Syria until he was a magnate in the Army, Navy, and Istanbul. So man went out to sea on an official mission from Istanbul to Basra, and since the Suez Canal did not exist at that time, the road from Istanbul to Basra was by sea. He had to cross the Mediterranean through the Gibraltar. Remember, the one who ruled Gibraltar, the king of the Mex, had the Atlantic bordering the Cape of Good Hope, so he was trying to go around Africa through the streets around Morocco, the Atlantic, to South Africa, up to the Indian Ocean, the Persian Gulf. So upon reaching the Atlantic, the torrential sea whirlpools led them to what is today Rio de Janeiro in Brazil. So that one account being written. So imagine how many times this happened to people on that sea, in boats and ships, since the beginning, since the first ship or boat or beast. Yeah, that there might have been plenty more islands in between when the sea rise, and like people look at Atlantis sinking as some fantasy disaster sinking, but it could have been just waters rise to the point that sometimes we got islands, different islands, that would be bigger islands, different, you know, because they ain't nothing but ground under all the water, so you know. But there's been an account written. And say it is a very interesting book that they left the ship to the shore and people came to say, Assalamu alaikum. They personally believed that they made fun. In principle, believed that they made fun of him. In a long history, he discovered the existence of a secret Islamic group and decided to stay there. In fact, he stayed among them for a year, going back and forth from one country to another, gave these Islamic group a name. So basically he was saying he gave them a name as something to write in the story and discovered their way of life. I gave that book to one of my students at the Afaros Islamic University of Cordoba in order to obtain a bachelor's degree and to translate it from Arabic to Spanish. She was a Portuguese girl and promised to translate in her language too. And I probably guarantee you they had trouble getting that through. Something like that. As much as the United States act like they don't know what's going on, all these people in the United States, corporate Hollywood world, that the world follow on, and much as they try to suppress it, at the same time, lead me to believe that they probably try to stop them while I'm here in return. That part of the world clung to Islam. In fact, talking about Brazil, there is a book entitled Deep Roots, which was published in Guyana, which is in Brazil, and had a look at it because it deals with the existence of Africans in America before Columbus, which was just damn Africans in America in that sense. They've been wherever they've been before any of these words been created, but at the when we look at Africa from the standpoint of this word, just include America. Because this will America be called before America. One of the names. But I like to make sure we don't fall into that trap to think Africans in America, because that's still paying you back to thinking as that at one point dark-skinned people ain't been over here, then they came over here to somebody else's shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, stop it. We ain't got no records that show that they ain't, we ain't, that dark-skinned people ain't never been here. We ain't playing with these people. What I want to highlight, because many people have a lot of interest in the subject, the Duchess herself was going to offer a wing of her palace to found a school specialized in relationships between Al-Andalus and South America before Columbus. So they're working on some stuff. Maybe she passed. I am pleased, as you know, to organize a seminar on the subject, and I have thought about organizing an international conference in which we will not only bring the Duchess of Medina Sidonian Abd el-Hakim Quick, but many specialists on the subject, in whose majority, unfortunately, would not be Arabs or Muslims, but they are the scientific audacity. You need audacity to even deal with the subject, because you're dealing with millions of so-called black people, the biggest economic, the biggest, the most paid attention to, political power group of people. Namely, the United States. So, this subject definitely gonna get some press every time. They've been trying to just get people who just like scientists, linguistics and stuff like that, instead of religion. So it wouldn't be no, you know, biases and that. So you say, first you will have to know our true history. How can we Moroccans not know that half of our Amorovid state was in Africa and other in Europe, and that we don't know that another part was in America? And so the Duchess of Medina said, don't have to tell me. And she gave me documents that prove that Islam existed in Guyana. I cannot believe it. So, they can interview her in a second. And I am totally sure that this existence in our documents, this exists in our documents, but we have not been able to read them, you see. He realized that too. It exists everywhere. We just think we define things differently, modernly. Since reaching that story is like deciphering a hieroglyph. You have to know how to interpret it, because sometimes you could be talking about Sudan while in reality you are talking about the America of that time. And we know that's a fact. If you watch the last few videos, you can probably tell better than me if I'm talking about the canary over there all the way. He came to two cities located in the mountains. One was called Sala. And again, so I'll go a whole bit more, but. Good thing about the internet, nothing is lost. The Medina Sidonia Palace belongs to a famous person in history of Spain, Guzman el Bueno, direct ancestor of the Duchess who settled there in 1297, who came from a Moroccan Muslim family, the Hoffman, who acquired the Duchess, should have known of knowing America already by those dates. And she find birth certificates being of family members being born in Alkmaar. And one of those visits we made to his palace, we were lucky to hear from his lips, her lips, because it was Manuel Bueno, 1297. This they talking about when the people who write this on his form actually going to visit before she passed. And one of the visits we made, the Hustle TV channel did too on the DVD. Made the most rural Europe to interview her. She said a good bit on that. That won't spit over my head when I first see that when I've been younger. Probably look at that now, like, oh yeah, they cut her off. They cut her off. They can't, they tell her you can't use the term America when you talking about more. But she even ready to tell him, she tell him that in so many words, but no, I was saying the word America verbatim. For those people who can't really hear. And one of the visits we made to the palace, we were lucky to hear from her lips the true story of this noble family of Muslim origin, to one of whose branches also belonged to the famous Andalusian poet Ibn Guzman. So she been, if you look at the documentary, she been saying not only her family, but all a bunch of European families did that ethnic cleansing to hide doubtful origins. The Duchess told us that one of her ancestors secretly kept a hammer and copy of the Quran in a chest whose key was always hanging around her neck. Quran that appeared to be read locked in her room without anyone seeing it. And it's the palace that they're talking about. See the roof and the Lucy. Very significant is the document which some fishermen who fished between the waters of Cape Kenaga and present-day Colombia refused to pay taxes to King Felipe II, claiming that they were waters that belonged to the Moors and that they pay taxes to the Sharife affairs. Technically, the trip to America from Andalusia or Morocco was easily taken advantage of the scrape of trade winds. In a little more than a month, it was navigated without difficulty to the islands of Venezuela. The documents provided by the Dutchess shows that it was common to travel to America from the Muslims traded peacefully with America without the need to conquer or oppress its inhabitants. And if you read the book, you see that they was the Americans. So, you know, ain't no need to, we gonna conquer or oppress yourself. I mean, they been fighting each other, but we know we call that Indian Wars. Tribal wars, the same, that's what that is, if you want to talk about that. But this model of Islamic commercial relationship worked well for a long time until the arrival of aggressive European capitalism that, in the name of the Catholic Christian civilization, destroyed the best of American civilization. The history of the discovery of America by the Christopher Columbus is, according to the Duchess of Medina Sidonia, a monumental fraud. And she ain't had no chill. She don't got no chill. I mean, you should know that if you read them pages. A monumental fraud intended to try to legalize the conquest of a vast territory that was not only already discovered, but maintained economic, religious, and political ties with Moroccan and Andalusian Islam. The book contains in many interesting facts that it would be long to list them. And that's why I got like 10 videos on that one book. So much, so the most important thing in this book, however, is that it put us in the need of restudying our history from a new point of view. And once you get the idea that Africa been from Peru to Australia, east and west, and Florida to Chile, north and south, spreading across the whole planet, then everything starts to realize how much different. You start to see it all over the place. Every time you see the word Africa in certain history books, you start to think about it, like, damn, I wonder what you're talking about, really. I would like to encourage those who are interested in the thesis of the Duchess to organize a congress to study more closely the hypothesis that she exposed in the book. And I think I'd say that when I'm in video, I need a goddamn team for this shit. I think that for Morocco and for Spanish Muslims, it would be a great opportunity to move towards a recognition of our common history and to strengthen even more the bonds of fraternity that already binds us, but also for American Muslims, so Moorish Americans, it would be an excellent opportunity to feel part of the same family that were once united by the figure of the Sharifa of Morocco. According to her, there were trips to America since the time of the Phoenicians and as at the end of the 9th century. Andalusian Muslims frequently traded with the course of what is today Brazil, Venezuela, and Antilles. The document in question
say that Dr. Zamuddin Sinoy told the BBC, make it clear that there is historical confusion. Make that clear. What the ancients took for Africa was really America, say the Duchess. So there you go, chapter 47 begins. Between 16 degrees north, so that's where I just finished explaining. Before the Catholic monarchs, the Pope Alexander. Pope Alexander VI, Aragonese of origin, set up the discovery to get Portuguese competitors out of the way and validate legal trade that was done since ancient times. Going back to chapter 47. That was evidence showing. And those records been Andalusian records. Almost coming up around modern times. We still matter of fact her archives, that's where those records is in her archives that she researching from. They've been the commercial records of the world in Andalusia, Spain. Sources were overlooked. I published facsimiles of them in my book, Necessary Talking. And in some, we clearly see the attention to deny the evidence. The doctors warned the BBC that there are documents that were written by and care of lyrics of the 18th and 19th century. So people came later and write on those documents. That be careful and stuff like that. I have used those documents. Only one is enough to disrupt all. Let's see. Absolutely all of Colombian history. Damn sure do too. But we already know that some bullshit ass history. They just don't know what is in place of that shit. As Moorish Americans, we know. Fucking Moorish American history, that's what's in place. But to the world, they know Columbus' story is a fraud, but they don't know what the story is. What she scrutinizes, we present a book based not on beliefs, not on ideology, not on direct mentalities or apparent thoughts, but on documents. And you damn sure got documents on every page. Documents that exist and can be verified today and now. On the other hand, the official doctrine is supported by what the pulpits have said and what the powers has affirmed for 400 to 500 years, and they have no documents. They usually have no joke. Called by Tito Drago, honorary president, or that's on the International Press Club. That's somebody who's been interviewed. BBC, I think. Briefly, a document, I'm not sure to talk, a document 1463, Henry IV grants lands that are titled to some gentlemen and talk about river fisheries and rivers with fisheries. River fishing is one of high wealth. And the Moors, by the way, titles are from the Moors. Then I they find that they are Muslims, that they are rivers of fishings, and that that is between the end of Aguirre and Borjador. So she's showing us how she come to make those maps that we've been looking at. I go to the map and I meet Agadir and Cape Borjador in front of the Canary Islands, in front of Lazaro. We have contact with the University of Leiden in Holland, where Dutch government is trying to, I had talked about this in the last video, trying to recover the language of Guyana. To her surprise, the person in charge of the study had found a vocabulary of Spanish, but not the Spanish of the 15th or 16th century, meaning supposed to have come, right? By the Spanish that corresponds to the 13th, so that's the 1200s. Does this have much to do with what you presenting here? Do not, do it not, if you don't mind, I'll put them in. So they're talking to her. So, wonderful, what is the order document here? So I guess they're in the palace. One is of 1128. The concession of King Alfonso to Santa Maria de Carquero. Since when is all this here? The house from the 12th century, and my ancestor Guzman El Bueno settled here in 1297. Who gave the dagger to the Moors to kill their son before giving up the square? It is my direct ancestor, and that happened here. He was a Muslim converted to Christianity. So, because they really did not know that. So basically, because his biography was a little made up by the family. But there is a 1288 document that tells us that Alomar, he was born in Alomar. That is in Africa, no, in America. So do not, how was he born in America in the 13th century? Columbus did not get there to the 14th. Because there was navigation and commerce with America since long before Columbus. Sorry, you're baffling me. It has been a historical confusion. There were trips to America from Phoenicians. So we're going right back to Canaanites. The story we took for trips to Africa were, in fact, trips to America. The historians will get on top of it, basically. No, they don't even listen to me, so that's her. They don't want to know anything. I explain all this in my book, and nobody has made a review, except for me. And I provide documents from the Medina Sidonia Archive, and also from others. So I listen to her. Let's see more documents. The corn is of American origin, right? Isn't it? Well, a document by Alonso de Palencia said it was grown in Granada in 1456. So he asked for more. From here, from San Luca de Barrameda, Spain, a navy of 35 caravels came out in 1478, organized by Isabel La Catolica. Four caravels in the crown and the rest private individuals. They went to Guinea and the gold mines. According to you, America, right? Yep. Read the documents. When arriving at the River of the Slave, quote unquote, it was ordered that they pass first the royal caravel and later the private ones. It was then a large river. There are no rivers like that on the coast of Africa with such large mouths for thousands of years. So, that's a little bit of background. What we dealing with is this. Series. Let's see you. Let me finish the next one. The last one that cut off on me. Dealing with the Canary Wars. We'll get back in there. And the Guinea Wars.